Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our outstanding producer, Mr. Aaron Zommers, on the board. It is Thursday, January 11th, 2024, 6 minutes now past the hour of 1 o'clock. Glad to have you along with us. High atop State Street, a block off the Capitol Square, where, at least for right now, sunny skies here in Madtown in Madison after a little bit of a light snowfall today. Lots more weather, winter weather coming across the state, particularly those listeners on WRCE in Richland Center and also up in the La Crosse area, our station there, WLCX, and also WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids as well. Those areas, or at least parts of those areas, under a winter storm warning starting tonight. Basically, the rest of our listeners, say from Eau Claire and Green Bay South, are under a winter storm watch. Our listeners in Amory, up in Hayward as well, and Park Falls, those folks maybe might not get quite as much snow, but basically anything from, say, Black River Falls and over to Green Bay and south could receive anywhere between 7 and 11 inches of snow now, is what they're saying. And this snowfall, unlike the last one, is going to be lighter, fluffier, because the temperatures will be colder, so it will add up quicker. And also, maybe even as much or more treacherous in terms of driving. Sometimes we're going to get wind gusts 45 to 50 miles per hour tomorrow into Saturday. So that's going to make driving very, very difficult. So if you are in a line, say, from Green Bay over to La Crosse and south of that, up to 7 to 11 inches of snow over that part of the state, gusty winds as well. So keep your radios tuned here to the Civic Media Radio Network, and we will continue to update you on what you need to know in terms of weather and so much more. So be aware of that. Sports-wise, last night, big night for Greg Gard and the Wisconsin Badgers. Number 15, Wisconsin, went down to the Ohio State Buckeyes and beat them 71-60. The Badgers led most of the way until the fourth quarter when Ohio State went on a run, but so did Max Klesmit. I listened last night on the Civic Media app, as you can, via WRCE in Richland Center, Matt LePay, Brian Butch on the call. Max Klesmit had 18 points in the second half. Lights out shooting. Wisconsin now the only unbeaten conference team in the Big Ten and sits atop the Big Ten in the standings. Meanwhile, Marquette, number 11 in the country, Shaka Smart and his crew struggling a little bit. They lost at home last night by a score of 69-62. Butler over the Marquette Golden Eagles. So Wisconsin, though, when the new polls come out, Wisconsin, I mean, I think they should be a top 10 team.
Seems that way. Marquette, though, missed it by that much.
They missed it there. But yeah, hopefully Marquette will. Because I want to see, the only time I'm not cheering for Marquette is when they play Wisconsin.
Which, of course,
the Badgers beat them this year. So that was fantastic. But anyway, the Badgers doing fantastic. I really think, we said this at the beginning of the season, I saw a couple of online sports people saying this is the best Wisconsin team since the team that went to the national championship in 2015. Now, I'm not prepared to tell you right here today that Wisconsin's going to get back to the national championship game, but I think they could make a very deep run in the NCAA tournament. So Wisconsin right now leading the Big Ten. You can listen to the Wisconsin Badgers. They have a big game, by the way, Mr. Zommers, coming up on Saturday. This Saturday, they will host Northwestern, who is actually, believe it or not, number 2 right now in the Big Ten. And that broadcast is set for 10 a.m. It's a weird morning game.
That is weird.
It's a 10 a.m. broadcast on this Saturday as Wisconsin hosts Northwestern. You can hear it in Wisconsin Rapids, Richland Center, Amory, Racine, Kenosha, or you can also stream it, of course, on the Civic Media app, Wisconsin taking on Northwestern. Tonight, the Milwaukee Bucks will be hosting the Boston Celtics. Broadcast time, 6 p.m. tonight. The Bucks take on the Celtics. You can hear that on several stations across the network, including Oshkosh, Richland Center, Amory, Park Falls, and Racine in Kenosha. Quick note, due to the professional sports contracts, we are not allowed to stream the Bucks broadcast. You have to be in one of those cities, but still, there's your... And one other quick sports note before we move on. Big days for retirement yesterday in both the NFL and college. Probably the biggest one, in my opinion, Nick Saban, the longtime coach of Alabama, or as Keith Jackson, the great broadcaster, like to call him, Alabama. Nick Saban decided to hang it up yesterday. Goes out an SEC champion, conference champion, lost, of course, in the national semifinal to Jim Harbaugh and the Michigan Wolverines, who, of course, went on to win the national championship over Washington. But Nick Saban calls it a career, at least we think. I mean, who knows? Lots of openings in the NFL. Maybe Nick Saban at 71 years old goes to the, or 72, goes to the NFL.
Nobody in sports ever retires and then immediately goes back to play again or coach again, right? Never.
It all comes down to the dollar sign. Bill Belichick, the coach of the New England Patriots, one of the winningest coaches in the NFL, he and Robert Kraft, the owner of New England, reportedly came to a mutual agreement to leave. Not sure if that's the case, but anyway, he is leaving. And also Pete Carroll, longtime coach at Seattle, won a Super Bowl with Russell Wilson in Seattle. You know, and I thought when I saw this yesterday, I thought, well, I don't know, Pete Carroll's been there 8, maybe 10 years. Pete Carroll has been in Seattle 14 years. I mean, because I remember when he won national championships at USC in college, which doesn't seem like that long ago to me.
But clearly
it was. Again, pandemic time, you understand? The pandemic has messed me up in my head. It's that 2 to 3 year window where it just throws off my, well, that happened so many years ago. And I always have to add 2 or 3 years because of the pandemic.
Yeah, I had a similar thing last night where my roommates and I were talking about the Call of Duty line of video games and how they used to be really good and then they took a dive towards mediocrity because, you know, they make so much money. Like you said, it all comes down to the dollar signs. They just keep cranking them out. And I said, yeah, all the ones in the last 10 years kind of sucked. And then so I went the opposite direction. I was like, because of COVID, it's probably 10 years ago. No, it's probably like 7 or 8. Where they really started getting terrible.
It does it to us all, the COVID memory. Anyway, we're going to be talking more sports in this hour. We're going to be looking at this little spat between Aaron Rodgers and Jimmy Kimmel, hearing from Jimmy Kimmel on that, getting your thoughts on that. Also, I've got an idea, a bright idea, pun intended, in terms of how we can support the Packers. Of course, the Packers coming up this coming Sunday. You can hear the game on Civic Media on select stations as they take on the Dallas Cowboys. But right now, I want to turn our attention, and I get that this is more of a local Madison issue for people in Madison, but I think that it's a great reminder, no matter where you live in the state of Wisconsin, because, you know, having grown up in Southwest Wisconsin, an hour away from Madison, and of course, politicians, I was probably guilty of this during my days in politics as well, living and running for office in rural Wisconsin. There is a great tendency to beat up on the city of Madison and Milwaukee, but in particular, Madison. I think it was former Governor Lee Sherman Dreyfus, the great late Governor Lee Sherman Dreyfus, now would be considered a moderate Republican. Did you know this? Lee Sherman Dreyfus signed into legislation the first bill in America protecting LGBTQ folks from discrimination in the job workplace.
I did not know that, but that's awesome.
Yeah. Way before his time, Lee Sherman Dreyfus. What a great guy. But I think Lee Sherman Dreyfus coined the phrase that Madison was 75 square miles surrounded by reality. So, you know, I mean, it was just one of those things you did. And I want to make clear, I love living in the city of Madison for the most part. So many things to do here. So much to offer. I am pro-Madison. But there is a stereotype, and somewhat deserved, around the state that, you know, Madison goes to a few extremes when it comes to environmentalism or when it comes to preservation, that, you know, they go a little too far. Look, I am a conservationist. I believe in protecting the environment for future generations. But I also think you have common sense. I'll never forget when I was working in state government that we had a constituent who had purchased a piece of property. It was already designated, zoned to build on. And it happened to be next to a lake. Well, the DNR found a cattail, one lone cattail on the property and tried to shut him down. Now, look, you can find cattails in a lot of places in Wisconsin. It's not an endangered species, right? An endangered plant. So anyway, at the end of the day, the DNR decided to compromise and the people could build their house. But I think this is a good reminder, this situation here in Madison, that sometimes Madison is not what it pretends to be. Case in point, and we're gonna pick up on this and welcome your phone calls as well, by the way. Over in, if you're familiar with the Nakoma neighborhood, very nice neighborhood, one of the older neighborhoods in Madison, near the Madison Arboretum. And there is a neighborhood here within Nakoma where developers met. And so the main part of this is that there is a historic building, all right, on this site. The Landmarks Commission designated this building. And in fact, let's just do the story here from the Wisconsin State Journal this morning. It says, the Madison City Council on Tuesday rejected an effort by some neighbors and historic preservationists to stop the construction of a home next to the Old Spring Tavern, a historic landmark near the UW Arboretum on the west side. A group of neighbors of the site, and it gives the address, filed an appeal with the council over a November decision by the Landmarks Commission that found plans for a two-story home were appropriate for the historic site. The former tavern, now a private residence, was built before the start of the Civil War and served as a stagecoach stop for travelers. The city named its landmark in 1972, and in 74, it was added to the National Register of Historic Places. Now you have a couple, the Furloughs, who want to build, and my understanding is they're not even in Wisconsin, they're from out of state. They want to build a 4,200-square-foot home on a vacant piece of property on the west lawn of the historic site. So this property was part of the site. The previous owner bought it and split it between where the historic building is and kind of the yard, basically. And these people want to put a 4,200-square-foot modern home and cut down a 200-year-old tree to put up this house. Here's the kicker. The city negotiated on this for 18 months and never told the neighbors. We'll tell you the rest of the story on the other side. It's the Todd Allbowles Show on Civic Media.
There is unrest in the forest. There is trouble with the trees. For the maples want more sunlight and the oaks ignore their pleas.
Welcome back to the Todd Allbowles Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along with us. 20 now past the hour of 1 o'clock on Thursday, the 11th of January. Talking about this, and I realize this is a nuanced situation and is Madison specific. But I think it addresses this stereotype that somehow Madison is always, you know, going to go with the pro-environmental, pro-historic preservation. And I think it's worth pointing out, and quite frankly, taking the city of Madison, the council, to task a little bit. And I guess at the end of the day, it's not so much the decision, the final decision that irks me. It's the process that has seemingly been ignored. And we've had people from the neighborhood, from that were against this on this show. And the city council has just, here in Madison, has seemingly ignored them. I got a copy of a letter from one of the neighbors in the neighborhood who sent this to the Madison city attorney. He said, yesterday, I was sent a letter regarding the city of Madison's failure to notice a hearing, and the person attached the letter. The letter indicated that I had canvassed everyone on the mailing list that was supposed to get a notice, except for the owners of the landmark property and the UW Regents. This letter indicated that the remaining 20 recipients on the list should have been contacted. 18 did not receive the notice, and the other two had not responded as of the time of this writing. I am writing to update those figures. Of the remaining 20 recipients on the list who should have been contacted, all 20 did not receive public notice. So here's the thing. The city of Madison negotiated these people. They want to put a 4,000-plus square foot modern home next to a historic building in Madison, cut down a 200-year-old tree, get rid of all the green space, basically, add to the runoff into the Arboretum water. And finally, they were supposed to, by statute, by ordinance, they were supposed to notice everyone in the neighborhood. And the neighbors canvassed themselves, basically. And, you know, in a city, you know, it depends on how far away you live from the affected property. So if you follow Madison City ordinance, there should have been 20 homeowners that got notice of this and would have had an opportunity to come before Landmarks Commission, the city council, and present their case. No one received these. And when the city of Madison was questioned, they said, well, we send it to the post office. Now, what's interesting, and I didn't know this before this story broke. With the U.S. Post Office, you could, with, I guess, technology now, you can have the post office send you an email of all the mail that you get. They track it now. So you can see what pieces of mail you were supposed to have. And if you were supposed to have something and it didn't arrive, you can say, hey, either the postal person forgot to put it in my box or someone stole it or whatever. The interesting thing is I know at least one of these people that were supposed to get a notice have that service with the postal service, and they never got emailed for this notice. So clearly the city of Madison, either the postal service lost it to all 20 notices before they were put into the system, or someone at the city of Madison dropped the ball. When the city was notified of this, they basically said, well, I don't know. We sent them out. So these neighbors never really got a fair shake at what they were at building a case. There was no real hearing here. There was no process. And I guess that's the part that really irks me as someone who spent some time on a city council back in Richland Center, obviously much smaller. But the point is the same. It doesn't matter whether we're talking Washington, D.C. or Madison or the city of Milwaukee or Eau Claire or Green Bay or Madison. Citizens should still have a right for a due process. And it's very disappointing to me that people here in the city of Madison, the Common Council last night, the council rejected the appeal by the neighbors on an 11-9 vote. Here's the people that actually went along with the neighborhood that voted for the appeal. This is for our Madison audience. Barbara Harrington McKinney, Isidore Knox, Amani Latimer Burris, Charles Maidas, Marsha Rummel, Kristen Slack, Bill Tischler, Mike Revere, and Narsa Welly. I'm sorry if I didn't pronounce that. Those are the people that did the right thing and voted for the appeal. The rest of the other 11 members of the council last night went against the neighborhood. Now, look, I'm all for thoughtful development, but I'm also pretty big on historic preservation. I'm also pretty big on saving a 200-year-old tree that's in good, healthy condition. Because once you destroy these historic landmarks, and again, the land, I get it. The building itself is still going to stand. But I don't know. Go to Mineral Point and look at some of those historic homes there. Go to Taliesin in Spring Green, the great Frank Lloyd Wright. What if someone bought the field next to Taliesin and said, you know what? We're going to put up a 10-story Hampton Inn, right? Once you do that, you ruin the aesthetic forever. So the next time you hear Madison, you know, is all about historic preservation and environmentalism, not always. Sometimes they drop the ball. Look, we're all human. But it's unfortunate that this city council, the city of Madison, did not do the right thing by the neighbors here in the Nakoma neighborhood. My heart goes out to them and really for everyone to have this historic site ruined, basically, at the end of the day. Moving on, speaking of ruining things, Aaron Rodgers, former Green Bay quarterback, who now is with the Jets and appears on the Pat McAfee show, or at least he did until yesterday, has been making comments about Jimmy Kimmel. And by the way, somebody, the Chuckster from Racine texted in, says, joined the show late. Did you hear or report that a decision has been made that Aaron Rodgers is off the Pat McAfee show? We have not reported that. We're going to. That was on the docket here for today. So yes, Disney, and I don't know who at Disney did this, but someone said, you know what? We own both ABC and the Jimmy Kimmel show, and we also own ESPN. And we don't take kindly to Aaron Rodgers coming on and making accusations about Jimmy Kimmel being a pedophile. And this comes from the Jeffrey Epstein list, which was part of it, at least, was released here last couple of days. And last week on Tuesday, Aaron Rodgers insinuated to Pat McAfee that Jimmy Kimmel was going to be nervous about this being released, and insinuated that Jimmy Kimmel was on this list that went with Jeffrey Epstein on the plane, went down to this island where allegedly underage girls were assaulted. And of course, Jeffrey Epstein, on his own standalone charges, was convicted and mysteriously, quote unquote, died by suicide in jail. The list came out, by the way. Jimmy Kimmel's name was nowhere to be found. We're going to play Jimmy Kimmel's response, get your thoughts, and talk about the Packers taking on the Cowboys on Sunday. Don't go anywhere. It's the Todd Ball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.
Is number one. We on the frozen tundra like a blizzard. Opponents going under. We cracking Miller from Lombardi up to Lambo. Gotta see it. Cause I'm feeling so fly like a cheesehead.
Welcome like back to the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. This is Honors. What do you dial up there?
Higher Education presents Feeling So Fly Like a Cheesehead, an old music video that came out 13 years ago. Wow, that makes me feel old.
I love it. Fantastic. 34 minutes now past the hour of 1 o'clock. Thanks. This is why I love our listeners, because, you know, I get going. Sometimes the old dyslexia kicks in. And yes, the name of the show on ESPN is the Pat McAfee Show, or McAfee Show. Sorry, it's the McAfee. I'm pronouncing it wrong. Thank you very much. Appreciate that, Robert. Yes, it's Pat McAfee is the show on ESPN. That's the correct pronunciation. And here's the point. And again, I kind of avoided talking about this just because it's just Hollywood and it's just goofiness. But it's gotten to the point now where only because Rodgers spent so much time in Green Bay, and I am so thankful he is gone. And by the way, what is the deal with former quarterbacks of Green Bay? First, you got Brett Favre, which no one was a bigger fan of Brett Favre for many a year than Todd. And then he goes to the Jets himself, and then he retires after he was with the Vikings, and he just turns into a MAGA Trumpster person and posing for pictures of the golf course with Trump and endorsing him. And if that
and
wasn't
using state welfare money to pay for volleyball courts and all that good stuff.
You took the words right out of my mouth. If that wasn't bad enough, then he's alleged, we have to use the words alleged, it's still ongoing, that he attempted to persuade the governor of Mississippi to use state welfare money to build a volleyball stadium while his daughter was a student there. So, I mean, that's where Brett Favre went. Now you got Aaron Rodgers, who also leaves the Packers for the Jets, and now he's going on ESPN on the Pat McAfee show, and he is attacking, saying he wants to box Dr. Fauci, Anthony Fauci. I'm not making this up. Spreading lies about coronavirus. You know, saying that that horse pill, ivermectin or whatever the heck that.
Ivermectin,
thank you. Ivermectin. Saying that people should take that yet. I mean, the guy has just gone loony bananas. And now, here according to Entrepreneur Magazine, NFL quarterback Aaron Rodgers will no longer make his regular Tuesday appearances on ESPN's The Pat McAfee Show, at least through the remainder of the season. The decision comes in the wake of Rodgers' controversial statements, including an unfounded suggestion linking talk show host Jimmy Kimmel to Jeffrey Epstein and Rodgers' promotion of conspiracy theories. Rodgers, whose host Pat McAfee pays him. Did you know how much he pays him, Mr. Zomers?
No, how much?
Seven figures. Pays him. Rodgers gets seven figures to appear on the program.
To show up and say just yes. Lies.
Yes, because I guess it gets more clicks, more views. I don't know. It elicited backlash last week when he falsely accused Kimmel of having ties to convicted pedophile Jeffrey Epstein. New court documents recently unsealed in the case name individuals previously connected to Epstein. Jimmy Kimmel was not on the list. So God bless Jimmy Kimmel, because, you know, he's like, a joke's a joke, but here's the deal. There are people who are on the fringes of MAGA who believe this kind of stuff. And we've seen violence. We talked about this on Wednesday with Trygve Olson. I mean, his boss, Rick Wilson, just posted it on Twitter this week. Rick Wilson was again swatted this over the weekend.
And it's not the first time.
No, where people call in false things to police. They have SWAT teams and people with loaded guns, or law enforcement with loaded guns come. They don't know who's the good person or the bad person, and it puts everybody's life at risk.
He has received many a death threat.
Yes. And so Jimmy Kimmel's making the point of, look, people have come after me already. I don't need your help based on absolute lies. I want to pick up. I want to play a little bit of this. It's long, so we're not going to do the whole thing. But here's how Jimmy Kimmel talked on his monologue on Monday.
Already a crazy year, particularly for me. Did you hear this story about me and Aaron Rodgers, the former quarterback for the Packers? All right, so what happened is he's a Jets quarterback now. He went on a show on ESPN, the Pat McAfee Show, and out of the blue insinuated that I was nervous because the Jeffrey Epstein list was coming out. He said I was hoping it wouldn't and that he was going to pop a bottle of something to celebrate when he did. And then it did come out, and of course my name wasn't on it, and isn't on it and won't ever be on. I don't know Jeffrey Epstein. I've never met Jeffrey Epstein. I'm not on a list. I was not on a plane or an island or anything ever. And I suggested that if Aaron wanted to make false and very damaging statements like that, that we should do it in court so he could share his proof with, like, a judge. Because, you know, when you hear a guy who won a Super Bowl and did all the State Farm commercials say something like this, a lot of people believe it. A lot of delusional people honestly believe I am meeting up with Tom Hanks and Oprah at Shakey's once a week to eat pizza and drink the blood of children. And I know this because I hear from these people often. My wife hears from them. My kids hear from them. My poor mailman hears from these people. And now we're hearing from lots more of them, thanks to Aaron Rodgers, who I guess believes one of two things. Either he actually believes my name was going to be on Epstein's list, which is insane, or the more likely scenario is he doesn't actually believe that. He just said it because he's mad at me for making fun of his top knot and his lies about being vaccinated. He's particularly upset, I think, because I made fun of the fact that he floated this wacko idea that the UFO sightings that were in the news in February were being reported to distract us from the Epstein list. That was Aaron's theory that he shared, and I mocked. Well, let me show you the moment that
Let's kind of cut it off there. It goes on, and Zomers, I watched it. He plays the clip that where he made fun of Aaron Rodgers because Aaron Rodgers, in fact, went on Pat McAfee's show and made these outrageous claims. And I think the important part later in Kimmel's monologue from Monday was he said, look, the difference here is we actually, on our staff, even when we make jokes about Donald Trump or other people, we make sure that we base it on something that actually happened. So we're actually basing our joke on the truth. Versus Aaron Rodgers, who's making insinuations without fact-checking, and in fact, they are baseless, bold-faced lies.
And damaging,
And damaging to the point where it has endangered him, his family, and his kids, because it is just so outrageous.
And he also points out at the end, If you're looking for somebody who does show up on the list multiple times, he's got someone for you. And then shows a video of Donald Trump chatting up Jeffrey Epstein and pointing at underage girls dancing on the dance floor and making comments. And it's gross.
844-967-2789 if you'd like to weigh in on this Aaron Rodgers debacle and what your thoughts are on Jimmy Kimmel. I honest to goodness, I mean, I'm glad that I'm imagine that CEO of Disney, Bob Iger, said enough is enough. And said, look, McAfee is off the show, or Rogers is off of McAfee. Now, it's worth noting that Rogers usually doesn't appear after the regular season. So that was kind of convenient. But I have no time. I would not wear a number 12 jersey if you gave it to me. Forget it. I wouldn't wear a number 4 jersey if you gave it to me. Forget it. 844-967-2789. Mark from the SAC. Mark, thanks for listening. What say you?
Yeah, well, especially since now Trump is actually saying, no, I didn't know Jeff Epstein at all. Well, we have video and photographic documentation of Donald Trump side by side with Jeffrey Epstein. I mean, it is just the lies just come on a cavalcade, and they're paying Aaron Rodgers $1 million to talk smart. I mean, well, him talking smart at all anymore about anything other than football is asinine in the first place, because the guy has done nothing but make a jackass out of himself. Since he left the Packers.
Yeah.
His last season was, that he hurt the Packers that last season he was there.
And how about the fact, Mark, that Jordan Love was named for the second consecutive week as the offensive player of the NFL? Here's a historical note I did not know. That never happened to either Brett Favre or Aaron Rodgers. How about that?
Well, I think it's impressive, and more of what you hear about Love these days is that he actually works hard with his receiving core and the guys he hands the ball off to, and it looks like he really busts a gut to show his appreciation for his fellow players. And I haven't heard people stepping up and saying, well, that's what Aaron Rodgers was doing in the last part of his career.
Right.
But it is just the man paying this guy over $1 million just to appear on television is just staggers my imagination in the first place, because I don't think he contributes that much to it anymore.
No, I totally agree. I totally agree. Thanks for the call, Mark. As always, 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. What are your thoughts on this Aaron Rodgers, Pat McAfee dispute, Disney getting involved? And how about Jordan Love? Finally a quarterback that's not nuts. 844-967-2789. Karina in Milwaukee. Karina, thanks for calling. What say you?
Hi, Todd. I'm foreigner, right?
Right.
So the whole experience with football is a different one, because I can watch Man and Tights without the music only for 15 minutes.
Right.
And that's kind of like, that's it. I can't do this anymore. But I can appreciate everybody else's love, and I can see how much, and I don't know what it is in the other states, obviously, but in Wisconsin for Green Bay, this is a special love here.
Right.
Quarterback is a special baby for a whole Wisconsin. They babying and love and cherish and do everything there is to do.
Right.
For a quarterback.
Because I think part of it, Karina, is that we are the only NFL franchise in the NFL that is owned by the people. There's no one person that owns the Green Bay Packers. It is a community-owned team. It's literally a legal piece of paper that says if the Packers are ever sold, the profits go to the local VFW in Green Bay. No one person can ever profit from moving the Green Bay Packers or selling them. That's what makes it special.
Right. Well, you see, I didn't know that. But the thing is, maybe, and it probably explains my theory even better. Because I had the same question. I don't know a lot, but I can see the behavior change and the ridiculousness of both of those people.
Right.
So I think they're starving for attention.
I think you're right.
Because when they're getting out of Green Bay, they become just a quarterback.
That's a great perspective. That's awesome, Karina. You're right, because no other city loves their quarterback, I don't think, as much as – that's a great point, Karina. And when they go to other cities, okay, they miss that attention. Great call, Karina. Thanks. Appreciate it as always. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. One of my great friends texted in, and she said this, you know, and we talked about it briefly, but it bears repeating, that CEO Bob Iger of Disney – of course, they own both ESPN and ABC, so he has jurisdiction over both. But would Bob Iger maybe have gotten as involved if Aaron Rodgers went after, say, Stephen Colbert? If it was somebody outside of the Disney family? I think that's a great
point.
Probably not. I think it's a great point. 844-967-2789. Dick in Madison. Dick, thanks for listening. What say you?
Well... Here's the thing. Here's when I totally lost it with him. The drama queen being last year when he wouldn't cuss up and say whether he'd been vaccinated or not.
Right.
Real team guy, right?
Right.
And, you know, a lot of people, they don't name him by name, but they don't have to. Mm-hmm. Some of these kids that are playing there now, they said the difference this year is that, you know, they really want this bad, and you can see it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised to see him pick off Dallas this weekend. I really wouldn't.
I think you're right. But, I think it could cause some noise.
No. If anybody, they play very erratically. I know they've won 8 in a row at home, but now it's time for them to get a loss, right?
Right. Exactly. Dick, but, thanks.
No, Rodgers just so selfish.
Right. Thanks, Dick. Appreciate it. Here's my idea. I want your calls. Last segment of the show. Here's what I think, because I don't like taking down Christmas lights. Here's what I think we should do as Wisconsinites. Leave the Christmas lights up until either the Packers win the Super Bowl or we're eliminated. What do you think? Leave the Christmas lights up until the Packers win the Super Bowl or are eliminated. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Leave the lights up. Go, Pack, go. We're back after this on the Civic Media Radio Network. Like a head. Welcome back to the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 10 before the hour of 2 o'clock. That's 10 minutes away from Matt Flynn of Matt Flynn Direct. Breaking news, by the way, I'm betting you that Matt will have a take on it. According to CNN, the judge kind of reversed course in this trial today and let Trump talk for about 5 minutes in his closing defense. spoke for about 5 minutes. Trump said, here's a couple of quotes. Quote, the facts are the financial statements are perfect. There are no witnesses against us. The banks got all the money paid back. They were great loans. This was a political witch hunt, unquote. The judge let him go and then said to the attorney, 1 minute, that's all I'm saying. And then at 1 o'clock, the judge, Engeron, cut him off and said, quote, Mr. Kleiss, who's the attorney, this could have been done differently and you would have had a lot more time. Mr. Trump, thank you. That was it. So we will see. Maybe Matt Flynn will be talking about that much more. Matt Flynn direct after the top of the hour.
It's just like he said when we had him on the other day. It's doing your own closing statement, not representing yourself in court, is like doing surgery on yourself with a Bowie knife. You have no idea what you're doing.
Not a good idea. So here's my question. Or not really a question, a statement. What do you think about this? I say let everyone in Wisconsin leave your Christmas lights up. Now, maybe you have to take the tree down, particularly if it's a real tree. You don't want to have a fire hazard. But leave the Christmas tree up, or leave the Christmas lights, rather. Leave Christmas lights up outside until the Packers win the Super Bowl or are eliminated. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Of course, the Packers... you can hear them on the Civic Media Radio Network on select stations. Let's hope that one of your stations are selected. If you live in Richland Center, you can listen on the FM side, 100.9 WRCO in Richland Center. Also Racine, Kenosha, you can listen at 99.9 FM or 1400 AM. Also, 92Q Country, WCQM, up in Park Falls on 98.3. Beautiful Park Falls. So if you are in Richland Center, Racine, Kenosha, or Park Falls, you can listen to the Packers. Unfortunately, we can't stream them. But Packers kickoff, 1 o'clock is the broadcast time on Sunday. We'll have to double-check that. That might be 1 o'clock Eastern. I think it's noon in Wisconsin. We'll double-check that. Green Bay at Dallas. Of course, Mike McCarthy, former Packer head coach. Now, they're undefeated at home. The Cowboys are this season. So it's not going to be an easy game, but I agree. I think that the Packers have a shot in this. I think that I think they're gelling. I think if they can, you know, if Joe Barry and the defense can somehow hold Dak Prescott to a couple of touchdowns, I think the Packers have a chance.
I also think that whatever you read from must have had an old time on it because Green Bay at Dallas Cowboys on Sunday, the 14th, is 3:30 p.m. Central Standard Time. At least the TV broadcast.
I think that's correct.
And I can't imagine that the radio would be
somehow.
Usually the
radio is about
time.
An hour ahead of time. The pregame show, I think, is an hour ahead of time. So probably 2:30 for the pregame, 3:30 kickoff, Packers at Green Bay. Thank you, Mr. Zommers, for checking on that. So what do you think about this idea? Leaving our Christmas lights up, at least the outside ones, until the Packers win the Super Bowl, or until they're out of it.
And we got a text about this. Andrew from Maine took the words right out of my mouth. I was going to say this. Todd, if you really don't want to take your lights down, then leave them up until the Pack wins the Super Bowl, even if it's 2059.
Now, come on now. They're going to win it. They'll win another Super Bowl between 2050. I'm not sure I'll be alive in 2059.
Come on. But
844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. What do you think about this idea? Leaving the Christmas lights up until the Packers win the Super Bowl or are out of it. Let's go to CJ in Stoughton here in Dane County, listening on WMDX. CJ, what say you? Should we leave the Christmas lights up until the Pack wins?
Well, it's certainly a lot easier than having to take them down. I don't care what year it is, but I think Jordan Love's going to do an amazing job, and he's going to deliver a Super Bowl to Green Bay.
This year, do you think?
No, I'm not saying this year particularly, but I tell you what, if he can, you know, if all of them can stay healthy around him and get healthy, with Jones, the way Aaron Jones is running the ball, I think they've got an opportunity to do it all.
I totally agree. And one thing to keep in mind, of course, the Packers, the youngest team in the playoffs this year. So, you know, I think if the defense could get fixed, I think that the offense has the great basis to make a run here in the next couple of years. You know, do I think they could get to a Super Bowl this year? I would love to see it. I don't think it's impossible. Do I think it's probable? Probably not. But do I think they can win in Dallas on Sunday? Yeah, I think they got a shot.
Yes, and, well, the tight end, Ferguson.
Right. Oh, Jake Ferguson,
Dallas,
right?
Jake is playing some really good football.
He is.
And I hope it's a good game, but I'm rooting for the Pack.
Well, me too.
Real quick.
I want to make a quick note. Jake Ferguson, of course, the grandson of Barry Alvarez. What? Go ahead.
Yes, my father-in-law was one of his best friends.
So, really?
Future father-in-law, I should say.
Oh, very good.
But, I got to say about the Trump trial.
Sure.
If you look at it, really, with respect to the law, the contracts, there was no plaintiffs. Like you said, all the banks got paid. And when you go to buy a home, is it not the responsibilities of the bank or you to hire an appraiser and the bank feel comfortable with what the loan terms are?
Well, just make clear, I didn't say that. I read that. Those are Trump's comments.
All the money, this is all political. Letitia James campaigned on it. That's what she did. And this is, like they said, she met with Joe Biden a number of times during this period. And it's totally political.
All right. So, well, I appreciate your opinion, but I appreciate talking sports with you, CJ. The Packers, at least we can agree on the Packers. I appreciate that, CJ. Thank you so very much. So close. So close, but yes, missed it by that much. Jeff Perry, our ongoing contributor, writes in on Facebook and says, I love the Christmas lights idea. And by the way, I find it interesting that today's right-wingers often loudly complain about late-night shows poking fun at them. Can you imagine Reagan or Nixon publicly criticizing Johnny Carson over a monologue joke? But Trump and Rogers see no shame in doing it. Unreal, unquote. Great comment. That's a perfect place to leave it today. I think, you know, Reagan and Nixon were thicker-skinned. Tougher than some of the current Republicans out there. Great show today. Appreciate y'all for calling in and listening. Stay tuned. Our friend Matt Flynn Direct is next. Don't go anywhere. Until tomorrow, whatever you're fighting for, whatever you believe in, keep banging your drum.